Hello everyone, we at Bank Exams Today are happy to announce that along with our IBPS SO Law Officer Examination 2021-2022, we are also launching IBPS RRB Law Officer Examination 2021-2022 examination course. For all of you students who are willing to attempt this examination, as we all know that recently the notification for IBPS RRB Law Officer Examination has come. So for all of you students, we have prepared the course to help you out in this journey of your preparation and to make you comfortable and make you well prepared before the examination. So any student who wish to prepare for both this examination or one of the examination can visit our website and see the details of our course. And please use this coupon code while you enroll for any of our courses to avail the benefits which we are happy to give to the students. Thank you. Our topic of discussion is Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code 2016. In this video, we are going to cover multiple choice questions. We are going to solve and learn multiple choice questions related to the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code 2016 with reference to your examination. So let's begin. Our first question is, what is applicability of IBC? The very important questions that to whom the IBC is applicable. Who all are covered under IBC procedures? So, the options are, option A, companies incorporated under the Companies Act 2013 or under any previous company law. Limited Liability Partnership incorporated under Limited Liability Partnership Act 2008, partnership firms and individuals. Option B, companies incorporated under the Companies Act 2013 or under any previous company law. Hindu undivided family, partnership firms and individuals. Option C, companies incorporated under the Companies Act 2013 or under any previous company law, limited liability partnerships, incorporated under Limited Liability Partnership Act 2008 and cooperative societies registered under Cooperative Societies Act 1972. And last option, that is option number D, companies incorporated under the Companies Act 2013 or under any previous company law, trusts under the Indian Trust Act 1882, cooperative societies registered under Cooperative Societies Act 1972, and individuals. So, what is the applicability of IBC? And we have to choose a correct option among the four options given here. So, the correct answer is, a company is incorporated under the Companies Act 2013 or under any previous company law, limited liability partnerships incorporated under Limited Liability Partnership Act 2008, partnership firms and individuals. So the correct answer is option number A for the question, what is the applicability of IBC? It is applicable to the companies incorporated under the Companies Act 2013 or any other previous company law in India, LLPs incorporated under LLPs Act 2008, partnership firms and individuals. So, the provision dealing with the applicability of IBC is section number 2, part 1 of IBC Code 2016 deals with application of IBC. According to this provision, the provisions of this code shall apply to any company incorporated under the Companies Act 2013 or under any previous company law. Any other company governed by any special act for the time being in force, except in so far as the said provisions are inconsistent with the provisions of such special act. Any limited liability partnership incorporated under the Limited Liability Partnership Act 2008. Such other body incorporated under any law for the time being in force, as the central government may, by notification, specify in this behalf. Personal guarantors to corporate debtors, partnership firms, proprietorship firms, and individuals other than persons referred to in clause E. So this is about applicability of IBC, and the section which governs the applicability is section number 2 of part 1 of the IBC code 2016. Moving ahead to our next question. The next question is about who can initiate corporate insolvency resolution process. Options are: option A, only corporate debtor can initiate corporate insolvency resolution process. Option B, financial creditor and operational creditor can initiate corporate insolvency resolution process. Or option C, financial creditor, operational creditor and corporate debtor can initiate corporate insolvency resolution process. Or last option, that is option number D, corporate debtor and financial creditor can initiate corporate insolvency resolution process. So who among these can initiate corporate insolvency resolution process? So according to IBC provisions, option number C, that is financial creditors, operational creditors and corporate debtors can initiate corporate insolvency resolution process under IBC. And the provision related to this is section number 6 of chapter 2 of part 2 of IBC 2016, which says that where any corporate debtor commits a default, a financial creditor, an operational creditor or the corporate debtor itself may initiate corporate insolvency resolution process in respect of such corporate debtor in the manner as provided under this chapter. So it is clear and very evident that the answer that who can initiate corporate insolvency resolution process is, as per section 6, says that a financial creditor, an operational creditor or the corporate debtor itself may initiate corporate insolvency resolution process. Moving on to our next question. When can CIRP be initiated? That is, when can corporate insolvency resolution process be initiated? Options. Option A, the minimum amount of default is rupees 5 lakh or such higher amount which shall not exceed rupees 2 crore. In such defaults, we can initiate the corporate insolvency resolution process. Or option B, the minimum amount of default is rupees 1 lakh or such higher amount which shall not exceed rupees 1 crore. Or option C, the minimum amount of default is rupees 10 lakh or such higher amount which shall not exceed rupees 3 crore. Or option D, when the minimum amount of default is rupees 8 lakhs or such higher amount which shall not exceed rupees 3 crore. So what will be the minimum amount of default to initiate corporate insolvency resolution process? the answer is option B. The minimum amount of default is rupees 1 lakh or such higher amount which shall not exceed rupees 1 crore. Now, in a pandemic situation, the government has exercised their right to fix a minimum amount more higher than the 1 lakh rupees. So, currently it was fixed at, minimum amount was fixed as rupees 1 crore. To deal with many things, to cope up with the default scenario because of pandemic, the amount, minimum amount of default was increased to initiate the CIRP procedure. Now, section 4 of chapter 1, part 2 of IBC 2016 deals with when can CIRP be initiated. So, the provisions says that this part shall apply to matters relating to the insolvency and liquidation of corporate debtors where the minimum amount of the default is 1 lakh rupees. Provided that the central government may, by notification, specify the minimum amount of default of higher value which shall not be more than 1 crore rupees. Provided further that the central government may, by notification, specify such minimum amount of default of higher value which shall not be more than 1 crore rupees for matters relating to prepackaged insolvency resolution process of corporate debtors under Chapter 3A. Okay. So this is the provision relating to when can CIRP be initiated. Moving on, what is a default? So now we were talking about default, that minimum amount of default needs to be this much, then only we are eligible to take a remedy in IBC to initiate corporate insolvency resolution process. Now, what is a default actually? As per IBC code 2016. So options are, default is maybe option number A, non-payment of debt when whole or any part or installment of the amount of debt has become due and payable and is not repaid by the debtor or the corporate debtor. Option B, non-payment of debt when whole or part of the payment is demanded by the financial or operational creditor. Option C, non-payment of any amount, whether in full or in part, on demand by the creditors or concerned authorities. Or option number D, that is, default is any payment of the creditor that is subsisting. So, the correct answer is option number A, that is, default is non-payment of debt when whole or any part or installment of the amount of debt has become due and payable and is not repaid by the debtor or the corporate debtor. Now, this definition is given in the section number 3, subsection 12 of part 1 of IBC code 2016. And here, default's definition itself is given under option 1, which says that default means non-payment of debt when whole or any part or installment of the amount of debt has become due and payable and is not paid by the debtor or the corporate debtor as the case may be. Okay, moving on to our next question. What is debt under IBC? Now we have seen default, now we are going to consider debt. Earlier we were seeing that who can initiate the CIRP. So in that, the default word was very important, and in default definition, debt word is very important. What is considered debt under IBC? So option number A, any amount of money that is owed or due to any party. Is it a debt as per IBC or ऑप्शन नंबर बी, अ लायबिलिटी और ऑब्लिगेशन इन रिस्पेक्ट ऑफ अ क्लेम विच इज ड्यू फ्रॉम एनी पर्सन एंड इंक्लूड्स अ फाइनेंशियल डेट एंड ऑपरेशनल डेट, और ऑप्शन नंबर सी, एनी लायबिलिटी अराइजिंग इन रिस्पेक्ट ऑफ मनी एडवांस्ड बाय अ क्रेडिटर टू द डेटर, और ऑप्शन नंबर डी, डेट्स अराइजिंग आउट ऑफ लोन्स एडवांस्ड बाय अ फाइनेंशियल इंस्टीट्यूशन. सो विच वन इज द करेक्ट आंसर एज पर द डेफिनेशन गिवन अंडर आईबीसी फॉर डेट. सो डेट इज डिफाइंड अंडर आईबीसी एज ऑप्शन नंबर बी विच स्टेट्स एज अंडर दैट इज अ लायबिलिटी और ऑब्लिगेशन इन रिस्पेक्ट ऑफ अ क्लेम विच इज ड्यू फ्रॉम एनी पर्सन एंड इंक्लूड्स अ फाइनेंशियल डेट एंड ऑपरेशनल डेट. And the definition is given under provision section 3, subsection 11 of part 1 of IBC 2016. It says that, as we already learned, that debt means a liability or obligation in respect of a claim which is due from any person and includes a financial debt and operational debt. Both kind of debts are included and considered as a debt under IBC section 3 subsection 11. Moving on to our next question. Who is a financial creditor under IBC? These are very fundamental questions which can help you even solve a complicated questions, multiple choice question if asked in the examination. But these are the must know MCQs with reference to your fundamental knowledge, education in IBC, and also with reference to the examination point of view. So, who is a financial creditor as per IBC's definition? So, IBC recognizes a person as a financial creditor as option number A, any person to whom a financial debt is owed and includes a person to whom such debt has been legally assigned or transferred to. Option B, any person that has a claim on the services of a second party. Option number C, any person to whom a financial debt is owed. Option number D, any person who owes financial debt to another. So, which one is the correct answer amongst these four options? That is option number A, any person to whom a financial debt is owed or includes a person to whom such debt has been legally assigned or transferred to. And this definition of financial creditor, this recognition of financial creditor is governed by provisions of section 5, subsection 7 of part 2 of chapter 1, which says that financial creditor means any person to whom a financial debt is owed and includes a person to whom such debt has been legally assigned or transferred to. Okay, moving ahead to with our next question, question number 7. Operational creditor under IBC. We saw financial creditor, now it is about operational creditor. Who is a operational creditor as per IBC? So the options are option number A, a creditor whose liability subsists up to 6 months and is listed in the balance sheet. Option number B, a person to whom an operational debt is owed and includes any person to whom such debt has been legally assigned or transferred. Option number C, any creditor listed in the balance sheet of the corporate debtor. Or option number D, any person that has advanced loan to other person, another party. So, which one is the correct answer? The correct answer is for operational creditor under IBC, option number B, a person to whom an operational debt is owed and includes any person to whom such debt has been legally assigned or transferred. Okay. Moving ahead to the explanation related to this question. Which provisions under IBC governs the definition and recognizes the operational creditor? So, the explanation is given under section 5, subsection 52 of part 2 of chapter 1, which says that operational creditor means a person to whom an operational debt is owed and includes any person to whom such debt has been legally assigned or transferred. Moving ahead to our next question, that is, can operational creditor assign or legally transfer any operational debt to a financial creditor? Can operational creditor assign or legally transfer any operational debt to a financial creditor? Is it possible? So, the options are, option number A, yes, it is possible. However, the transferee shall be considered as an operational creditor to the such extent of such transfer, that even if it is transferred to the financial creditor, for that particular operational debt, the financial creditor will also be considered and treated as he is an operational creditor. Option B, yes, but the transferee shall be considered as a financial creditor in relation to such transfer. Or option C, that no, an operational creditor cannot assign or legally transfer any operational debt to a financial creditor. Or option D, no, an operation creditor can assign or legally transfer an operational debt only to an operational creditor only. So, if you have really understood the previous two questions, you can realize that it is already mentioned in the definition that they can assign or legally transfer their debt, whether it is an operational creditor or financial creditor, whether it is an operational debt or financial debt. Okay, so that is already solved. Now, only two options are left, which both of them says yes, you can transfer, assign and legally transfer any operational debt to a financial creditor. But how it will be treated as? So the correct answer is option number A, that yes, you can transfer, operational creditor can assign or legally transfer any operational debt to a financial creditor. However, the transferee shall consider as an operation creditor to such extent of transfer. I already explained this option, correct? So let's see the provision related to this. This is as per section number 21 and subsection 5, which deals with committee of creditors. Section 21, subsection 5 says that where an operational creditor has assigned or legally transferred any operational debt to a financial creditor, the assignee or transferee shall be considered as an operational creditor to the extent of such assignment or a legal transfer. Okay, you can also read entire section number 21, which deals with committee of creditors, to get better idea about this topic. So, moving on to our next question, that is question number 9. Who is a corporate debtor under IBC? So, as per IBC, who is considered as corporate debtor among the following options? Options are, option A, any person that owes debt to a company. Option B, a company that owes debt to any person. Option C, a corporate person who owes a debt to any person. Option number D, an entity that owes money to a financial institution. So let's find out who among the following is a corporate debtor as per IBC. The correct answer is option number C, a corporate person who owes a debt to any person. Okay, and why this is the correct answer? The explanation is given under section number 3 of part 1 of IBC 2016, which says that section 3 subsection 8 defines corporate debtor as: corporate debtor means a corporate person who owes a debt to any person. So our answer is option C, a corporate person who owes a debt to any person is considered as corporate debtor. Moving ahead to our next question, question number 10. Financial service provider is, who is a financial service provider? So the financial service provider is option A, a person engaged in the business of providing financial services in terms of authorization issued or registration granted by a financial sector regulator. Or option B, a person engaged in the business of providing all kinds of financial services. Or option C, a person engaged in any kind of a business where the authorization is issued or registration is granted by a financial sector regulator. Or option D, a person engaged in the business of providing all kinds of financial as well as operational services. So let's see who among the following are considered as a financial service provider as per IBC. So the correct option is option number A, that is a person engaged in the business of providing financial services in terms of authorization issued or registration granted by a financial sector regulator is considered as financial service provider under IBC. And with reference to which regulation? With reference to which provision? So provision number section 3 of part 1 subsection 17, that is section 3 subsection 17 of part 1 says that a financial service provider means a person engaged in the business of providing financial services in terms of authorization issued or registration granted by a financial sector regulator. Okay, this is the answer to our question number 10, that is who is a financial service provider. Moving ahead to our next question, question number 11. Whether IBC is applicable to person resident outside India? This is a very tricky question. If you know the definitions properly, then you will be able to answer this question very easily. So the options are option number A, no, IBC is not applicable to person resident outside India. Option number B, yes, IBC is applicable to person resident outside India. Option number C, IBC is applicable to a person outside India with the prior approval of the board. That means they are saying that if you have a prior approval of the board means IBBI, then IBC can be made applicable to the person resident outside India as well. So they are saying about, they are putting one condition. Or option number D, IBC is applicable to person resident outside India as well as to foreign persons. So what do you think, which one is the correct option? Option number B, that yes, IBC is applicable to a person resident outside India and there is no need of a prior approval of the board also. And which provision says that? let's figure it out. Explanation is given. As per the provision of section 3, subsection 23, part 1, a person includes an individual, a Hindu undivided family, a company, a trust, a partnership firm, a limited liability partnership firm, and any other entity established by a statute and includes a person resident outside India. So, a definition of a person under IBC includes a person resident outside India also. As per the provisions of section 3, subsection 23, part 1. Okay, moving ahead to our next question. Question number 12. Who is a regulator under IBC? Options. Option A, Reserve Bank of India. Option B, Insol India. That is in. Option number C, Insolvency and Bankruptcy Board of India. Or option number D, Indian Board for Insolvency and Bankruptcy. So, which is a regulatory body under IBC? Very simple. Option number C, Insolvency and Bankruptcy Board of India is a regulatory body under IBC. So, Insolvency and Bankruptcy Board of India is a regulatory body under IBC. The regulator under the code is IBBI or a board, which was established by Government of India on October 1, 2016. One of the core functions of IBBI is to regulate the functioning of other three important aspects dealing with the IBC procedures, that is insolvency professionals, insolvency professional agencies, and information utilities. So, IBBI is the regulatory body under IBC. Major functions of IBBI, that is board, are making regulations and guidelines on matters relating to insolvency and bankruptcy as prescribed under the code. Registration of insolvency professional agencies, insolvency professionals, and information utilities. Carrying out inspections and investigations on insolvency professional agencies, insolvency professionals, and information utilities. Collecting and maintaining records relating to insolvency and bankruptcy cases. Specifying mechanism for grievances redressal against insolvency agencies and information utilities. Promote transparency and best practices in its governance. So, let's move ahead to our next question. Which among the following is not entitled to initiate corporate insolvency resolution process? So, who is not eligible to initiate the process under IBC or take a remedy under IBC? So, options are option A, a corporate debtor in respect of whom a liquidated order has been made. So, already an order for liquidation is passed. Such corporate debtor cannot initiate the CIRP procedure. Is it the correct option? Or option number B, a corporate debtor has not gone through a corporate insolvency resolution process. Or option C, a financial creditor. Or option D, an operational creditor. So, who among the following are not eligible to initiate the IBC procedure or take a remedy under IBC by initiating CIRP procedure? The answer is a corporate debtor in respect of whom a liquidator order has been made cannot initiate corporate insolvency resolution process because already the order for liquidation is passed. So, the provision is section 11 of chapter 2 says that the following person shall not be entitled to initiate corporate insolvency resolution process under this chapter, namely A corporate debtor undergoing a corporate insolvency resolution process or a prepackaged insolvency resolution process. Or a financial creditor or an operational creditor of a corporate debtor undergoing a prepackaged insolvency resolution process. Or a corporate debtor having completed corporate insolvency resolution process 12 months preceding the date of making of the application. A corporate debtor in respect of whom a resolution plan has been approved under Chapter 3A 12 months preceding the date of making of the application. A corporate debtor or a financial creditor who has violated any of the terms of resolution plan which was approved 12 months before the date of making of an application under this chapter, or a corporate debtor in respect of whom a liquidation order has been made. So these are the criteria in which a person cannot initiate the corporate insolvency resolution process under section 11 of chapter 2 of IBC. Moving ahead to our next question. Which statement regarding information utility is correct? Options are: Option A. Information utility shall collect, collate and disseminate financial information to facilitate insolvency resolution. Option B. Information utility shall register the debtors and creditors as insolvency professionals and act as a storehouse of their information. Option number C. Information utility shall accept applications of corporate insolvency. Or option D. Information utility shall store information of all insolvency and bankruptcy cases. So, which among the following statements are correct with reference to information utility services under IBC? So, the correct answer is option A. Information utility shall collect, collate and disseminate financial information to facilitate insolvency resolution procedure. And the provision governing this statement is Section 214, Obligation of Information Utility. For the purpose of providing core services to any person, every information utility shall create and store financial information in a universally accessible format, accept electronic submission of financial information from persons who are under obligation to submit financial information under subsection 1 of section 215 in such form and manner as may be specified by regulations. Option D. Accept in specified form and manner electronic submission of a financial information from persons who submits such information. D. Meet such minimum service quality standards as may be specified by regulation. E. Get the information received from various persons authenticated by all concerned parties before storing such information. Provide access to the financial information stored by it to any person who intends to access such information in such manner as may be specified by regulation. Publish such statistical information as may be specified by regulations. Have interoperability with other information utilities. So these are the obligations of information utility services as per IBC. Let's move to the next question. What is initiation date in corporate insolvency resolution process? So options are option A, the date on which a financial creditor, corporate applicant or operational creditor makes an application to the adjudicating authority for initiating corporate insolvency resolution process. Option B, the date of admission of an application by a financial creditor, corporate applicant or operational creditor for initiating corporate insolvency resolution process by adjudicating authority. Option C, the date on which a financial creditor, corporate applicant or operational creditor realizes the insolvent status of the corporate debtor. Or option D, the date on which the corporate debtor is unable to pay its debts to the creditors. So, which among the following option is correct for considering the initiation date? The correct answer is, the initiation date in CIRPE will be the date on which the financial creditor, corporate applicant or operational creditor makes an application to the adjudicating authority for initiating corporate insolvency resolution process. And this is covered under provisions of Section 5, Subsection 11, Part 2, Chapter 1 of IBC. The definition of initiation date is, initiation date means the date on which a financial creditor, corporate applicant or operational creditor, as the case may be, makes an application to the adjudicating authority for initiating corporate insolvency resolution process or prepackaged insolvency resolution process, as the case may be. Okay, moving ahead to our next question, that is, now we saw initiation date, now what is the commencement date? Please do not get confused between initiation date and commencement date, because both are different under IBC. So what is considered as insolvency commencement date? Option A, the date on which a financial creditor, corporate applicant or operational creditor makes an application to the adjudicating authority for initiating corporate insolvency resolution process. Or option B, the date of admission of an application by a financial creditor, corporate applicant or operational creditor for initiating corporate insolvency resolution process by the adjudicating authority. Option C, the date on which a financial creditor, corporate applicant or operational creditor realizes the insolvent status of the corporate debtor. The date on which the corporate debtor is unable to pay its debts to the creditor. So, which one is the correct answer? The correct answer is option B for commencement date. That is, the insolvency commencement date is the date of admission of an application by a financial creditor, corporate applicant or operational creditor for initiating corporate insolvency resolution process by adjudicating authority. So when adjudicating authority admits the application made by financial creditor, corporate applicant or operational creditor to initiate the procedure under IBC, that date is considered as the commencement date. And section 5, subsection 12 of part 2 of chapter 1 deals with insolvency commencement date definition. We already read the definition, which says that means the date of admission of an application for initiating corporate insolvency resolution process by the adjudicating authority under section 7, 9 or section 10 as the case may be. Let's move on to our next question. That is question number 17. What is resolution plan? A resolution plan is option number A, a plan proposed by the financial or operational creditors for insolvency resolution of the corporate debtor as a going concern, or option B, a plan proposed by the adjudicating authority creditor for insolvency resolution of corporate debtor as a going concern. Option C, a plan proposed by resolution applicant for insolvency resolution of a corporate debtor as a going concern. Or option D, a plan proposed by a corporate debtor themselves for insolvency resolution of a corporate debtor as a going concern. Correct option is option C, a plan proposed by resolution applicant for insolvency resolution of the corporate debtor as a going concern. So, the plan proposed by the resolution applicant for insolvency resolution process is considered as a resolution plan under the provision of section 5, subsection 26. Definition of a resolution plan is as under. That is, resolution plan means a plan proposed by resolution applicant for insolvency resolution of the corporate debtor as a going concern in accordance with part 2. For removal of doubts, it is hereby clarified that a resolution plan may include provisions for the restructuring of a corporate debtor, including by way of merger, amalgamation and demerger. Let's move on to our next question. That is question number 8. Who approves the resolution plan? Very important. Options are option number A, committee of creditors approves resolution plan. Or option B, insolvency professional approves the resolution plan. Option C, adjudicating authority approves the resolution plan. Or option D, that is insolvency and bankruptcy board of India approves the resolution plan. So, who approves the resolution plan as per IBC? Committee of creditor approves the resolution plan under the provisions of section 30, subsection 4. That is submission of a resolution plan. So, subsection 4 of section 30 says that the committee of creditors may approve a resolution plan by a vote of not less than 66% of voting share of the financial creditors after considering its feasibility and viability. The manner of distribution proposed, which may take into account the order of priority amongst creditors, as laid down in subsection 1 of section 53, including the priority and value of the security interest of a secured creditor and such other requirements as may be specified by the board, provided that the committee of creditors shall not approve a resolution plan submitted before the commencement of the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code Amendment Ordinance 2017, where the resolution applicant is ineligible under Section 29A and may require the resolution professional to invite a fresh resolution plan where no other resolution plan is available with it. Okay. So, who approves the resolution plan? Committee of creditors as per section 30 subsection 4. Our next question is who constitutes the committee of creditor? तो ऑप्शंस आर ऑप्शन नंबर ए इंसॉल्वेंसी प्रोफेशनल, और ऑप्शन बी फाइनेंशियल ऑपरेशनल क्रेडिटर, ऑप्शन सी इंटीरियम रिजोल्यूशन प्रोफेशनल, और ऑप्शन डी एडजुडिकेटिंग अथॉरिटी हु कॉन्स्टिट्यूट्स द कमिटी ऑफ क्रेडिटर्स. सो द आंसर इज इंटीरियम रिजोल्यूशन प्रोफेशनल कॉन्स्टिट्यूट्स द कमिटी ऑफ क्रेडिटर्स. प्लीज रिमेंबर दिस, डू नॉट गेट कंफ्यूज बिटवीन इंसॉल्वेंसी प्रोफेशनल एंड इंटीरियम रिजोल्यूशन प्रोफेशनल. इट इज वेरी इजी टू गेट कंफ्यूज. इफ यू नो द प्रोसेस थरली, यू विल नॉट गेट कंफ्यूज इन दिस काइंड ऑफ ऑप्शन एंड इन दिस काइंड ऑफ क्वेश्चन विच आर रियली इजी टू अटेम्प्ट बट माइट ट्रिक यू इन दिस ऑप्शन. सो सेक्शन 21 says that the interim resolution professional shall, after collation of all claims received against the corporate debtor and determination of the financial position of the corporate debtor, constitute a committee of creditors. Correct? So moving ahead to our next question, that is question number 20. Who shall receive the notice of meeting of a committee of creditors? Options are, option A, only the members of committee of creditors. Or option B, members of committee of creditors, members of suspended board of directors and operational creditors, in case their aggregate due is not less than 10% of debt. Option C, members of the committee of creditors, operational creditors, in case their aggregate dues is not less than 10% of debt and special invitees. Or option number D, members of the committee of creditors and special invitees. So which is the correct answer for this question, that is who shall receive the notice of meeting of committee of creditors? The correct answer is option number B, members of committee of creditors, members of suspended board of directors and operational creditors in case their aggregate dues is not less than 10% of debt. So they are eligible to receive a notice of meeting of committee of creditors. As per provisions of section 24, which deals with meeting of committee of creditors, which says that the resolution professional shall give notice of each meeting of committee of creditor to A, members of committee of creditors, including the authorized representatives referred to in subsection 6 and 6A of section 21 and subsection 5. B, members of the suspended board of directors or the partners of the corporate persons, as the case may be. C, operational creditors or their representatives if the amount of their aggregate dues is not less than 10% of the debt are eligible to receive notice of meeting of creditors. Now here there can be the question which will be framed in such a way that who is responsible to dispatch notice of a meeting of committee of creditors. So here it is evident that the resolution professionals shall give the notice of each meeting of the committee of creditors. So it is a responsibility of resolution professional to serve the notice of a meeting of committee of creditors to all these eligible persons. Thank you everyone. I hope you got an idea about how to solve IBC related multiple choice questions. If you have any doubt in this, you may contact us at Bank Exams Today. Thank you.